Oh, hey, it's Pastor Mark. Welcome to Cross Connections online service. If you got a moment, why don't you invite a friend? You can get it at the address below. With that, we'll pass it off to Pastor Anthony for some more worship.
Let's pray. Well, God, we thank you for today. We are so encouraged, Lord God, that you are for us, Lord. We can believe your word. We can believe your truth, Lord God. Lord, we do agree, Lord, with the word that says, Lord, your love is better than life, God. And we thank you, Lord, for just the victory that we have in your son, Jesus. And God, would you just do a work in us, Lord? Would you just sing songs over us, songs of peace and songs of deliverance? Would you sing over your congregation, Lord, as we minister to you? Bless your name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. Then you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. You still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. 'Cause there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again.
There's nothing.
better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Yes, Lord. Oh, there's nothing.
Welcome, and thanks for tuning in to Cross Connection Church today. We're so glad that we get to bring you church at home. I'm Pastor Garrett, and here at Cross Connection Church, we're all about living life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus Christ. Part of the way that you can be living life in connection right now at home is through prayer. We want to be praying with and for you this week, right now, today, whenever you need it. You can go to prayer.lifeinconnection.com. I know there's a lot of stuff going on in our world, in our country right now, a lot of things to be praying for, but if there's something specific right now, God loves our specific prayers. Here at Cross Connection Church, we believe that God hears every prayer and he answers them too. So whatever you have going on, we would love to be praying with and for you. When you send it into prayer.life and connection, it goes to our pastors and our prayer team, and we get to pray with and for you right then and there. So again, don't hesitate. It is such an important part of what we do here at Cross Connection Church. It's such an important part of being a believer in Jesus Christ, is talking with him, praying to him, and he is such a faithful, gracious, and amazing God that we serve. So definitely would love to be praying with and for you this week. Our on mission, speaking of prayer, we would ask you to be praying for Dave Eubanks with the Free Burma Rangers. They are serving in Burma in a incredibly difficult place to serve the Lord in, and dangerous place to be serving the Lord right now. The Burmese army has basically broken their treaties, and they are dropping bombs, they are doing ground assaults, and Dave Eubanks with the Free Burma Rangers, they are helping what they call IDPs, internally displaced people groups. They're not only doing that, but they're helping render medical aid to these people, but most importantly, they're bringing the good news and the gospel of Jesus Christ to all those in Burma right now. So they're doing this under some, like I said, incredibly difficult situation times right now over there. So be praying for Dave's safety, for his team's safety, but also for Burma, everything going on right now over there. The believers are definitely under definitely a heavier persecution that is hard for us to consider and believe right now. So be praying with and for them. Dave Eubanks, again, with the Free Burma Rangers. They could use your prayers and support right now. So with that, we're going to be joining Pastor Anthony again. He's going to be leading us in a song of worship. This is going to be a time that we set aside for those of you who call Cross Connection Church your home church to worship the Lord with your giving. There's a couple of easy ways that you can do that. First, you can go to give.lifeinconnection.com online right there, and it's a very simple way for you to give online. Second, you can simply text to the number 84321 on your cell phone, and you can send any amount to that. It'll walk you through the process. And third, you can send your tithe or offering letter to our church address, 1675 Seven Oaks Road here in Escondido, California. So with that, let's go ahead and worship with Pastor Anthony. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Let's worship our great God together.
Oh, much that through all of these uncertain times that we can trust you, that even when we don't understand what's going on around us, Lord, we know that you go before us. We know that you see all and your plans are good and you have everything in your control, Lord. And we are so thankful for you, our Father. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
After more than a year of closures and shutdowns, I think that it's safe to say that each of us have learned a number of things about our government, our culture, the media, our local communities, and probably about our families and ourselves as well. I'm sure you've noticed that life can sometimes just go about on cruise control or autopilot. We all get into routines and patterns that just kind of repeat from one week to the next. Our lives are rather algorithmic. We live according to a basic conditional if this, then that routine. If Monday morning, then this. If Tuesday afternoon, then that. It is not until we hit some bump in the road, like a health issue, a job loss, a car accident, or COVID, that we find ourselves bounced out of our routine lanes. All of a sudden, we are, especially from a psychological standpoint, dysregulated. When you find yourself emotionally, spiritually, psychologically, or behaviorally out of sync, you will inevitably be triggered. We have a reflexive reaction or a shock when those kind of things happen. And you are then triggered to try to reorient back to something that is more normal. This is actually called the orienting reflex. Over the last year, nearly everyone you know has been shocked out of their normal routines, and everyone has been trying to orient back to something more steady, something more normal. This happens to individuals on a micro level every single day, but it is rare that entire populations are subjected to the same triggering event at once. What I mean is that individuals experience dysregulating events in life all the time. Several years ago, one of my very good friends, and some of you watching this knew him also, he had a bad stomach ache over a weekend, and then by Monday afternoon, his world was utterly turned upside down when he received the terminal diagnosis of pancreatic cancer. That's one of these individual experiences that comes in and shakes a person. Or 22 years ago this month, my youth pastor, Pastor Tony, who still faithfully attends Cross Connection Church, he was seriously injured in a mountain bike accident. Everything changed for him and his family instantly on a Tuesday afternoon in April of 1999. So people individually or as families go through these kind of triggering events from time to time. They happen all the time in people's lives individually, but occasionally, large populations are affected together by dysregulating events, things like terrorist attacks, earthquakes, hurricanes, fires, floods, and so forth. The upside of those kind of large-scale events is that they generally are very short-term triggering events, and life orients back to a moderate level of normalcy relatively quickly. But what we, throughout the world, have experienced over the last year has been a sustained event. This sustained bump in the road has been very challenging, and throughout all of it, all of us have been trying to navigate back to some sense of normalcy. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of hearing the words, the new normal. I'm even more tired of hearing myself occasionally say them, but in reality, that's what we all have been trying to reorient back to. Unfortunately, through all that has happened in the last year that is directly connected to this dysregulating event of COVID, there have been a lot of other major life-affecting and culture-altering events that we've experienced as well. Of course, there were things that were connected directly to COVID, shutdowns, closures. Those were the biggest and most impactful. But then there were other things that were unrelated to it. The death of George Floyd, the protests, the chaos that followed it, the insanity of a chaotic political season. Have you been able to have a conversation with anyone in the last year that hasn't been mostly dominated by these topics? The The fact that these things come up in nearly every conversation at one point or another is an indication that they weigh heavy on our minds. And not only do they weigh heavy on our minds, but they wear us out. Stress affects us in a very big way. It affects our sleep. It affects us emotionally. It affects our kids. And we see the effects of this prolonged stress, this cumulative stress on our entire society. Mental health issues have skyrocketed in 2020. I was recently interviewing a licensed clinical social worker, and she told me that her practice has been bombarded this last year. I certainly don't need to go into all of the particulars, but all sorts of negative effects of the degraded mental health of our society have happened in 2020. We've seen a horrible increase in a lot of different things related to mental health disorders and problems. In some respects, I think we kind of miss the boring routine. But one of the other things that I have noticed in myself and also in interacting with others, whether they are outside or inside the church, is that a lot of people have been brought to a place of realizing that their old normal, their old routines, may not have actually been the best. They were comfortable for us, but maybe not entirely healthy. They were routine, they were consistent, but maybe not totally sustainable. Population affecting and world altering events like what we have all experienced over the last year, they really do provide us an opportunity to reevaluate what we are doing and how we are doing it. I've definitely been doing a lot of reevaluating for myself, and I've realized in doing so that I actually like change about as much as the next guy, which is to say that I don't like change very much. But I've also been thinking about how everything that we have experienced as a church affects, alters, and changes us as a church. I had a remarkably routine life until 13 months ago, a life I had grown pretty comfortable and used to, and all of that has radically changed. And I'll be the first to admit that I've internally wrestled with those radical changes a lot over the last year, but the internal wrestling is kind of pointless because we actually can't not change in light of everything that has happened. We can't just go back to life as it used to be because that life no longer really exists. It's like, and maybe some of you have had this experience in the past, it's like when you were dating someone for a very long period of time and then they break up with you and they say, but I really hope that we can maintain our friendship. But you know, you just can't. It doesn't work that way. You can't go back to the way things were after these major events happen. So I've been wrestling with how all of this affects the church, the larger corporate church, and then the smaller body of Christ, our local church, as well. And what I want to do today and for the next probably 2 and maybe 3 weeks is to share with you some of the things that I think are important for us, both as a local church, but also as members of the larger church, the big C church, if you will, around the world going forward. What does church look like in a post-COVID world? And first, can I just say praise God that we are approaching, I think we're approaching, a time where we will be in a post-COVID world. I think we're all looking forward to a post-COVID world, a world hopefully without masks, hopefully that is much more reopen, where you know you can go back to movie theaters and concerts and dining inside and church inside and all that sort of stuff. Although I hate to break it to you, I do think that 10 years from now, you're still going to be seeing people who wear masks, especially during the winter season. But there will be a post-COVID time. Also, praise God, in a lot of ways, church still looks quite the same in a post-COVID world, because at a very fundamental level, church has remained somewhat consistent for 2,000 years, though the culture continues to change around it. So through a lot of cultural changes, there's still a lot of things that remain the same for the church, and it will continue to be that way, but there are some things that are going to change. What COVID has done is that, as I've said before, it has accelerated global and cultural and church trends. And it has also stripped away a lot of unnecessary structures within society and also within the church. In other words, COVID kind of causes a return to the basics for a lot of different things. So I want to talk a little bit about the basics of church as a whole, the big C church, but the basics of our church as well. And what I hope that it will accomplish is that it will give you a little bit of information about what you are a part of as a member of the church, but also what you're a part of as a member of our church, Cross Connection Church, and hopefully help you to plug in a bit more as a member of this church. So with all of that as a long introduction, I want to ask you some questions. Did you know that the church is not just an organization, although it is an organization, and it's not just an institution, although it is an institution? Did you know that the church is an entity? It is a living body, and it has a God-ordained purpose. The church is a living body with a God-ordained purpose. And what is that God-ordained purpose? Well, if you ask 20 different pastors, what is the purpose of the church? You will probably get 20 different answers, but each of those 20 different answers will have a lot of overlap. They might say things like, the purpose of the church is to preach the gospel, or the purpose of the church is discipleship, or the purpose of the church is worship, or the purpose of the church is fellowship, or ministry, or missions, or social justice. I know that one makes some people really uncomfortable. A lot of pastors, when they are doing their academic work, if they got a theological education before they became a pastor, a lot of those pastors will at some point write a paper on the purpose of the church. Some pastors doing graduate studies will actually do their thesis on the purpose of the church. One well-known pastor even wrote a book about 25 years ago called The Purpose-Driven Church, Pastor Rick Warren. And in his book, The Purpose-Driven Church, he writes what a lot of pastors see as a good summation of the purpose of the church. He says that the church exists to grow warmer through fellowship, deeper through discipleship, stronger through worship, broader through ministry, and larger through evangelism. So those five things are what he says is the God-ordained purpose of the church: fellowship, discipleship, worship, ministry, and evangelism. All of those things are good, and all of them are important. And I think that you could make a solid biblical case that each of them are the purposes for which God has called his church into being. And it is from those things that every church establishes its mission and its vision. Some of you are in business and kind of big corporations where you're on the team, the executive team that talks about mission and vision and values and all of those things. So a lot of businesses and organizations and institutions have mission statements and vision statements and value statements, and they have a purpose for which they exist. And the church has a God-ordained purpose. And then it also has a mission and a vision, and local churches have that. So the church has a God-ordained purpose, which is given to us expressly in the scriptures. It encompasses things like fellowship, discipleship, worship, ministry, and evangelism. And it has a mission as well. And the mission of the church is to fulfill that God-ordained purpose. Let me say that again. The mission of the church is to fulfill the God-ordained purpose. And a church's vision is how it and its leadership envisions or sees itself fulfilling that mission to fulfill that purpose. And at Cross Connection Church, we have said for many years that our vision, mission, and purpose are summed up in this way. Cross Connection Church exists to live life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus. We want to experience, express, and extend life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus. We believe that life, true and abundant life, are found ultimately through Jesus. Jesus taught in John chapter 10, verse 10, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy, but I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly." Just a few chapters after that, Jesus said in John 14, 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And in John chapter 11, he reveals that he is the resurrection and the life. The Gospel of John opens by telling us that in Jesus was life, and that life is the light of men. For some of you, this is review. You've heard this dozens, if not hundreds of times, but sometimes it's good to be reminded of these things. Important things need to be restated over and over again. Look both ways before you cross the street. Brush your teeth every morning and night. Chew with your mouth closed. Don't talk with your mouth full. Don't hit your sister. Important things need to be reiterated. So Garrett says it every week in our announcements, life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus. And I say it frequently in my messages. Our name, Cross Connection Church, it reaffirms what our mission, vision, and purpose are. Our website is lifeinconnection.com. We use the hashtag lifeinconnection in our social media. This is kind of an important thing that we drill into you constantly. If you attend Cross Connection Church, if it is your church, then we want you to know life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus is our mission. It is our vision. But more than just knowing it intellectually, we want you to know it experientially. We want you to discover in your life what it means to live life in connection, first with God, and then with one another within the body of Christ, the church, and then with the world through missions and outreach. I'm convinced that this is really important. And as we move into a new season as a church, I want to emphasize the importance of this by talking a bit about this over the next few weeks. And I want to share with you how I hope this will be a part of our lives as those that are a part of this church. What does it mean to have life through Jesus? What does it look like to live that life in connection with God? How does that practically play out in our lives on a daily basis, where we can actually come in contact with the God of the universe, the God who made everything, to have those transcendent encounters with Him in daily life? I want to learn what that looks like more and more. How do we live this life in connection in fellowship with one another? What's it look like to actually be the body of Christ, to fulfill the one another's of Scripture? And what is our responsibility in bringing this life through Jesus, this good news that comes through the gospel, this life through Jesus and connection with God and one another to those who are in the world that don't yet know this life, those that you live next door to, those that you work with, those that you go to school with, those that your kids play soccer with? How do we bring that message to those people? And all of this is especially important because you and I were created to live life in connection with God and one another. That was the way that God originally made us. We're going to look at that even next week in the book of Genesis briefly. You and I, we do not fully live until we have this life through Jesus. This life through Jesus and in connection with God and one another is the abundant life that is spoken about there in John 10:10, where Jesus gives one of his purpose statements. I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. But this abundant life is not only a life here in this world, it is a life that extends on into eternity. It culminates and climaxes in eternity. This life in connection fulfills the purpose for which you and the church were made by God. Fellowship, discipleship, worship, ministry, evangelism, all of those things are part of this mission, this purpose. And as we return to basic rhythms of church and basic rhythms of social life, hopefully we will get to that post-COVID life in the not too distant future. But as we do, it's my hope that we can more fully experience these things. I hope that we can discover more fully what it looks like to actually experience connection with God. I hope that we can build new routines of connection with one another, whether it's gathering corporately at the church or gathering in small groups and homes or gathering as service teams at church or in the community or gathering within businesses or even on mission trips in other countries, and of course, this new rhythm of connecting and gathering with one another online. One of the things that I've shared several times over the last few weeks is that Cross Connection Church is now focused on developing connection, life in connection, on campus, online, and in homes. And this is something that you'll hear a lot more about going forward on campus, online, and in homes. And when I say that, I think that it's really a return to the basics of the church. The church 2,000 years ago gathered corporately wherever they could. Before they had buildings, it was in public and open spaces and in homes. So on campus and in homes. And they used the technology of their day to share the scriptures at a distance. They didn't have YouTube, they didn't have the internet, they didn't have podcasts, they didn't have social media. The technology of their day was letters carried by letter carriers. And Paul would write letters and he would send them to the churches and he would encourage and strengthen and teach them at a distance, just in the same way that we're using technology in our day to do that. So that was the technology of Paul's day, letters. And thank God that he did write those letters because we have them to be able to read and study through today, to be encouraged as well. So the technology of our day is things like YouTube and podcasts. And I am praying about and working toward this life in connection on campus, online, and in homes. And I hope that you will help us to make this more of a reality because you're a part of that. If you are a part of Cross Connection Church, then you are a part of extending this life in connection with God, one another, and the world on campus, online, and in homes. And this is where we are headed. And this is what I hope to expand upon in the next couple of weeks. And as a close today, I want to read a portion of scripture, which has been one of the key passages that I've turned to every time that I talk about this life in connection. In Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 14, it expresses this whole thing very, very well. There we read these words, "For he himself, Jesus, is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross." This is life in connection with God, with one another, and the world through Jesus, through the cross. So he brings them together in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. "And he came and preached peace to you who were afar off, to those and to those who were near. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers, no longer foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also, being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit." Interestingly, the verses that follow those verses in Ephesians chapter 2, in Ephesians chapter 3, are like a huge parenthetical break. And then Paul returns to his thought, and he writes this in Ephesians chapter 4. So after he says that in Jesus we are all built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit, he says this, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you, I beg you, that you would walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all." Life in connection with God, one another, and the world through Jesus. This is what you and I and our church were made for. Father God, I pray that you would continue to unite us together as one body, as we have one hope, and we've been baptized into one church. And you are our Father. You are above all and through all and in us all. And we pray, God, that you would work in and through us, your church, that you would join us together in a really powerful way, and that we would begin to learn more fully, experientially, what it is to be in connection with you through prayer and through studying the scriptures and through worship together and through serving together and through all the different ways that you desire that we would connect with you, that we would learn what it is to connect with you, but also to connect with one another and to live out the one another's of the scripture, to love one another and to pray for one another and to bless one another and to care for one another, all of that. Lord, teach us what it looks like to fulfill the one another's of scripture, and that we would extend that to this world, that we would go into all the world, especially the world right here in our own community in North San Diego County, and we would share the good news of your grace, the good news of salvation, the good news that brings us near and reconciles us who were once at war with you, enemies of yours, and that you would, Lord, help us to share that good news of reconciliation with the people that we live next door to, family members who don't know you, friends, co-workers, neighbors who don't know you. Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be a light, sharing the glory of your grace and truth with other people. So God, help us to learn in this new season that we're coming into what it is to live life in connection with you and with one another, and to extend that to the world, this life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, help us to know what that looks like and to fulfill that more effectively, whether it's on campus, gathered together, whether it's in homes or online, however you want to use us. Lord, help us to do that, we pray. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Did not despise the Christ, for even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died.
Now this gospel truth of all shall not
Father God, would you pour out your Spirit upon your church this week and bless them? Cause them to be a bright light shining to those who are in darkness, to those who are in need of your grace and your love and your truth. Lord, work in your church that we would be a conduit of your love and grace to others. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now may the Lord bless and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. God bless you.
Hey, Cross Connection. We are just past Easter. We've begged you guys, pleaded with you guys, even got maybe a bit threatening with you guys about inviting someone to church. The nice thing is Easter's over, so you can take a break. Don't even worry about inviting people to church anymore. I'm kidding. Of course we're kidding. Invite someone to church, guys. Come on, please.
Keep inviting people to church.
Invite somebody to church.
Don't get caught not inviting somebody to church.
Put your hands back on the hood.
And if somebody could invite a lawyer, we would appreciate it.
Hey, it's still important. Keep inviting people to church.
Invite someone to church. People need Jesus. Just go on the freeway, you can tell. People need Jesus. Invite somebody to church.
Online or in person.
Invite somebody to church.